Satan, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Sing it out, Jesus is alive.
Welcome. Good morning, everyone. I'm Chris Dalton, a member of the congregation here, and we have an all-age service this morning, so we're all staying in the main part of the church building. But I guess if you get really fidgety or one of the grown-ups with you, you could go through to the lounge. We're going to begin with a prayer. Let's pray. Loving Father, thank you that we can come together to sing your praises, bring our prayers to you, and hear from you through your word and by your spirit. Please help us to bring glory to you. Amen. Amen. In a sad and broken world, it's good to remember our God is a faithful God. Please stand to sing. Yesterday was the anniversary of the death of James Hannington, in whose memory this church was named. But what do you know about James Hannington? Whether you're here for the first time or you've been here for lots of years, you all have the same chance of getting this right, because it's a true or false quiz, and we've been practicing already. If you think it's true, big thumbs up. If you think it's false, thumbs down. Here's the first one. James Hannington only had one thumb. True or false? Okay, one thumb up. The answer is it's true. He started life with two, but when he was young, he was trying to smoke out a wasp's nest, and something went a bit wrong with the dynamite. Don't try this at home. James Hannington went to study at Cambridge, age 21. True or false? Right, we've got a mixture. Lots of you are saying false. You're quite right. He went to Oxford. James got his degree, but he failed his exam to become a vicar. True or false? Some of you have been doing homework because you knew there was a quiz, I'm sure. It's true. It's true. He failed his exam to become a vicar. After seeing a vision of the Lord Jesus, James tried again and was accepted. True or false? Oh, a nice mixture. I like that better. It's false. It's false. A friend wrote him a letter when he was in a time of turmoil about his faith, and he went forward. James became a committed Christian after he became a curate. True or false? It's true. It's true. The same friend sent him a book, and he found one day as he was reading it that the only important thing was to know, are my sins forgiven or not? Six, James came back to Sussex and was put in charge of the Chapel of St George in Hurstpier Point, and also did medical work. True or false? It's true. I think we've got the thing from St James Chapel up the back there. He helped a doctor amputate a man's arm. Probably didn't want to know that. In 1882, James was married, he had three children, and he had a growing desire to go to tell the people in Africa about Jesus. But his wife didn't want him to go. True or false? False. Lots of people said to him, don't go, but his wife actually supported him. Yeah, there you go. James had to return to England after 2 years because he was ill before he even reached Uganda. True or false? It's true. He became very ill and had to return home. James went back as the first bishop of Eastern Equatorial Africa in 1885, expecting that his wife and family would later join him there. True or false? It's true. It's true. He did go back out after some time. The doctors said he was good to go. James was speared to death in 1885 on the borders of Uganda, but no one knows exactly where he's buried. True or false? It's false. His body was recovered and he's buried outside the west door of the cathedral at Namarembe. At the bottom of the thing it says that his last recorded words were, tell the Kabaka, that's the king, I died for Uganda. If you want to know more about James Hannington, I have three old books that you are welcome to borrow if you see me afterwards. The God James Hannington trusted in is the same God Christians believe in today. And we have an opportunity now to affirm our faith. So please stand. I'm going to ask some questions. And if this is what you believe, please answer enthusiastically. The response is, we do. Do you believe in God the Father, who made the world and loves it so much that he sent his Son?
We do.
Do you believe in God the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who came to earth to rescue you from sin by his death on the cross, and by his mighty resurrection to give you forgiveness and eternal life?
We do.
Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to those who trust in Jesus and lives in all believers, helping them to live for God?
We do.
We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We're going to remain standing and encourage each other to worship our amazing God in the next song.
Come and stand before your Maker.
Come and stand before your Maker, full of wonder, full of fear. Behold his power and glory, yet with confidence draw near. For the one who holds the heavens and commands the stars above is the God who bends to bless us with an unrelenting love. Rejoice, come and lift your hands and
sit down. We're going to have our first reading, and Denise and Stephen, Timo and Evie Marie are going to come up. And as they do, if you'd like to follow the reading, it's from Genesis 24, can be found on page 23 of the Church Bibles and will also be on the screen. And after the reading, Nick will come and speak to us.
And the Lord had blessed him in every way. He said to the senior servant in his household, the one in charge of all that he had,
"Put your hand under my thigh. I want you to swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the God of earth, that you will not get a wife for my son, the daughters of the Canaanites, among whom I am living, but will go to my country and my own relatives and get a wife for my son Isaac."
The servant asked him,
"What if the woman is unwilling to come back with me to this land? Shall I then take your son back to the country you came from?"
"Make sure that you do not take my son back there,"
Abraham said.
"The Lord, the God of heaven, who brought me out of my father's household of my native land, and who spoke to me and promised me an oath, saying, 'To your offspring I will give this land,' he will send his angel before you so that you can get a wife for my son from there. If the woman is unwilling to come back with you, then you'll be released from this oath of mine. Only do not take my son back there."
So the servant put his hand under the thigh of his master Abraham and swore an oath to him concerning this matter. Then the servant left, taking with him 10 of his master's camels, loaded with all kinds of good things from his master, for Aram Naharaim, and made his way to the town of Nahor. He made the camels kneel down near the well outside the town. It was towards evening, the time the women go out to draw water. Then he prayed,
"Lord, God of my master Abraham, make me successful today and show kindness to my master Abraham. See, I am standing behind this spring and the daughters of the townspeople are coming out to draw water. May it be when I say to a young woman, 'Please let down the jar that I may have a drink,' and she says, 'Drink, and I'll water your camels too,' let her be the one you have chosen for your servant Isaac. By this I will know you have shown kindness to my master."
Before he had finished praying, Rebekah came out with her jar on her shoulder. She was the daughter of Bethuel, son of Milcah, who was the wife of Abraham's brother Nahor. The woman was very beautiful, a virgin. No man had ever slept with her. She went down to the spring, filled her jar, and came up again. The servant hurried to meet her and said,
"Please, give me a little water from your jar."
"Drink, my lord,"
she said, and quickly lowered the jar to her hands and gave him a drink. After she had given him a drink, she said,
"I'll draw water for your camels too until they have had enough to drink."
So she quickly emptied her jar into the trough, ran back to the well to draw more water, and drew enough for all his camels. Without saying a word, the man watched her closely to learn whether or not the Lord had made his journey successful. When the camels had finished drinking, the man took out a gold nose ring weighing a becker and 2 gold bracelets weighing 10 shekels. Then he asked,
"Whose horse are you? Please tell me, is there room in your father's house for us to spend the night?"
She answered him,
"I am the daughter of Bethuel, the son that Milcah bore to Nahor."
And she added,
"We have plenty of straw and fodder as well as room for you to spend the night."
Then the man bowed down and worshipped the Lord, saying,
"Praise be to the Lord, the God of my master Abraham, who has not abandoned his kindness and faithfulness to my master. As for me, the Lord is letting me on a journey to the house of my master's relatives."
Wow, wasn't that fantastic? Should we just give him a little round of applause? That was really good. Well done, guys. Now, I don't know about you, but hearing that reading made me think about a story I know. Maybe you know it too. There was once a beautiful princess. And she went for a walk in the woods. Tra-la-la. And as she walked through the woods, she came upon a well. And there at the well, what should she see but a frog. And as she was looking at the well and looking at the frog, she heard a voice saying, "Down here, down here." And she looked down, and there was a frog. And the frog was speaking. And the frog said, "I can see that you're a beautiful princess." She said, "Yes, I am. I can see that you're a beautiful princess. And I am a handsome prince." And she said, "No, you're not. You're a frog." And he said, "No, I am a handsome prince. And if you will but kiss me, I will be restored to my princely form, and we shall be wed on the morrow." And the princess, she looked down at the frog, and she picked him up, and she put him in her pocket. And the frog said from her pocket, "What are you doing? You haven't kissed me yet." And she said, "No, that's right. There are plenty of handsome princes around, but a talking frog? My friends are going to love you." Now look, there's a reason that story works as a joke, isn't there? It's because we know that story. We know the story of the princess who goes to the pond or the well, to the place where there's water, and supernaturally is united with the handsome prince, and together they live happily ever after. We know that story, don't we? And that reading from the Bible sounds a bit like that kind of fairy tale. And actually, it's a bit easy to read it that way. You read it and you think, oh, wow, look, here's God providing a wife for the prince. Because Isaac is a prince. God is providing a wife for him. Isn't that lovely for him? Isn't that lovely for them? This is a love story. It's like a fairy tale. Well, here's the thing. It is a love story, and it does sound like a fairy tale, but that's not the point. As we're going to discover this morning, Genesis 24 is a really long chapter. We're going to hear the rest of it read in a moment. I'm so grateful for the dramatic way it's being read to us, because otherwise it would feel like... I read it at 8 o'clock this morning for the 8 o'clock service, and by about 9 o'clock I'd just about finished reading the passage. Why does God spend so long in Genesis 24 telling us this love story? Telling us about how the prince finds his princess? Well, look, there's some clues. If you've got page 23 open in your pew Bibles, you can see them with me. It's obviously a really big deal. Abraham gets his servant, his chief servant, the most important person in his household, to swear this really solemn oath. "Put your hand under my thigh." It's an incredibly intimate thing. "I want you to swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and earth, that you will not get a wife for my son from the daughters of the Canaanites among whom I'm living. Don't you dare let him marry anyone from here where I am. You have to go to the place my family is from and get him a wife from there." But then the servant kind of understands how these sorts of things work. He says, "Well, what if she won't come back with me? Shall I take your son there?" And Abraham says, "Make sure that you do not take my son back there." So, okay, let's get this right. So Isaac's got to have a wife from there, but he's not allowed to go there, and he's got to stay here, but he's not allowed to have a wife from here. That's what this story is about. Why? I wonder, can anyone tell me what Isaac's name means? Does anyone know what Isaac's name means? Yeah. Isaac's name does mean Isaac. It also means something else. Do you know? Laughter. Do you remember that from the Bible? Isaac's name means laughter. Why does Isaac's name mean laughter? Well, his mum had never been able to have children. And God promised Abraham and Sarah that they would have a baby and that that baby would be very special. Now, Sarah had never been able to have children. And by the time God's angel appeared to Abraham and finally said, "Your son is going to come next year," do you know what she did? She was back in the tent. She didn't think the angel could hear, and she went. So that was laughing, not sneezing. She laughed. She was like, "That's hilarious. I can't have children, and I'm very old. It's so silly that you would say that I'm going to have a baby." Well, the angel said to her, "Give it a year. I'll come back and we'll see who's laughing." So the angel comes back a year later and this baby has been born. And so they call the baby Laughter, Isaac. Because it's hilarious that he even exists. You see, God made a promise to Abraham that from him would come a great nation. And through that nation, everything would be put right. The world would be healed. The world would be mended. Human beings would come back into a relationship with the God who had made them, and every sad thing would come untrue. That's what Isaac's name means. It's amazing, brilliant, hilarious news that he even exists. And God has a plan. And we've seen, if you've been with us through Genesis, we've seen that lots of the time it doesn't look like God's plan can possibly come true. And this is another one of those moments. Isaac doesn't have a wife. How can he be the answer to the promise that there are going to be great nations who come from Abraham? How can he be the answer to that promise if he doesn't have a wife? So Abraham says to the servant, "Go. Go and find a wife for my son, but he mustn't be from among the Canaanites." Why not? Because they were people who, not only did they not know God, they hated God. And they lived lives that showed that they hated God. They lived what Genesis tells us are wicked lives. Don't let Isaac marry someone who's going to lead him away from worshiping God. So she can't be from here. But he can't go back there because he's got to stay in the place that God promised. So the servant goes. And he meets Rebecca. And where our reading ended, he's seen that his prayer has been answered. Abraham was right. An angel has gone ahead of him. He's prepared the way. He's found the wife. And Rebecca and Isaac together equals blessing for the whole world. We'll see why later.
Thanks. Abraham and his servant knew that God is trustworthy and kind, but we aren't always, so we have an opportunity now to say sorry. If you'd like to join in, the response is, "Please forgive us." The words will be on the screen. Loving Father, you are one God, and you tell us to love you with all our heart, with all our soul, and with all our strength. We're sorry when we don't. Please forgive us. Loving Father, you're the one who gives us every good thing, but often we're not grateful. We're sorry when we're not. Please forgive us. Loving Father, you've told us not to forget you when things go well for us, but often we do. We're sorry when that happens. Please forgive us. Loving Father, we thank you for all your promises, and especially for promising to forgive us when we're sorry and tell you so. We thank you. Amen. Over to you, Ben.
Thank
Thank you very much, Chris. Good morning, everybody. It's lovely to see you all. Just to begin with, we're going to say a really big thank you to somebody. So, Wendy, come on down. Big round of applause, just like the price I've got. Yes, that's it. Yes, go whooping. Yes. Excellent. I'm going to grab the microphone now. Excellent. Wendy, this is a little bit of a delayed thank you, but it still is a very big thank you. We want to say thank you for all the work that you did in the office. Now, I asked Wendy earlier, I said, Wendy, what was the best thing about working in the office, just through those doors over there, in your time here?
I have had a few minutes to think about this, and there's lots and lots of really good things about working in the office, and I think what I'm about to say is probably something that I'd never dream of saying at the beginning. I think the best thing, actually, is the people that come in to see you. Now, sometimes it's the last thing you want when you're busy, but it is lovely that people come in and want to share their lives with you, so I think that's probably the highlight.
Excellent. And we are delighted that although you've moved on from the office, you haven't moved on from us as a church family. So what have you been up to these last couple of months? What's been the shift and change for you?
So back in September, I started working for a charity called Biblical Counselling UK, or BCUK, which has been started by a curate who used to be here, Steve Midgley, who, those of you remember, he was curate here about 24 years ago. And it's basically a charity that provides training and resources to help people in local churches really help them apply the Bible to all aspects of their lives, whether they're going through good times and bad things, but particularly to help people who are really struggling and help people to walk side by side with their friends and their families who are really struggling. So that's the main thing. And I get involved with doing really what I was doing in the office, finance and operations, so that bit hasn't changed, but the organisation has.
And
apart from that, I have also started helping at Rooted, yeah, which is amazing. Yeah. So, yeah. So.
Get that, yeah. And how can we be praying for you and the family at the moment?
I still think praying for the adjustment. I went from, busy working in the office 4 days a week to being not quite so busy. So just still praying for adjustment, praying what God wants me to do, how he wants me to fill my time. I sort of want to be really busy, but then I don't want to rush into things that maybe are not the right thing. And I've been saying this since sort of June, July time. Right? And so, yeah, just to pray that I start doing the right things and have the right opportunities. Yeah, thanks.
The thing which I was always grateful for Wendy, she was always very willing to help if I come along saying, "Oh, Wendy, can you just do this for me, please?" And she would straight away, without any grumbling or moaning, and also just helping us as a church to think, how can we keep moving forwards? How can we keep being prepared? Which was really helpful, so that not so we can be a slick organisation, but actually so we can help people to know about Jesus. So thank you so much for all that you did. All right. Big round of applause. And let me pray for you just before you slip off, and we've got a few little things too. Father, thank you so much for Wendy. Thank you for her love that she has for you. Thank you for the love you have for her. And we pray now she changes and adjusts this new part of life, that you'd help her how to use her time well, how to use well at BCUK, but also to serve in other ways. And we pray that each day she may know she's a beloved child of yours. Amen. And there's a few little gifts that we've got just to say thank you. Little token. Oh dear, that's probably should have done something about that, but there we go. There you go. Brilliant. Thank you so much, Wendy. Big round of applause again. Thank you. Wonderful. A few quick dates. The 2nd of December is the Panto. Yes, you're getting there. Set the pantomime. It's a great thing to sign up. Sign up online. £6 for children, £12 for adults, or a family is £36 to sort of cap. So the 2nd of December. 19th of November is our big welcome party. Don't forget to sign up for that. The 19th of November, Saturday. And then next Sunday, the 6th of November, yes, it is November already, It will be our bereavement service at 3 o'clock. If you've got a loved one whose name you'd like us to read out, then please do come and grab me at the end, and we'd be delighted to read that person's name out for you. That's 3 o'clock here next Sunday. And also, today is the last Sunday of our Mission Awareness Month. Throughout the month, we've had various people come to preach and share. We've had prayer meetings in the week. We've had little slots after the service. And today is our last opportunity for that. After the morning service, after this service, we've got a very quick prayer meeting for about half an hour to pray for the Salvianos and the Russells. They were unable to join us in person, but we'll be praying for them. But we're also going to be praying for Claire and Ruby. Ruby, do you want to come and Claire, Ruby, do you want to come and come down to the front? Big round of applause for them as well. So just as a, it's like a game show style. Do you want to grab the microphone? Now, some of us who were with the Webbs at the prayer meeting a couple of weeks ago, they shared that they were going to a conference. So Claire and Ruby, what have you got to do with that?
So we are going to be travelling to Malaga on Friday to look after Toby and Gabriel while James and Carolyn go to a training conference. So we're going to be childminding, teaching and anything else to fill the time between 8 a.m. and 8 p.m. each day for a week.
So, yeah. 12 hours, so everyone's going... Wow. So you're going there to help with childcare, but why would you want to do that? Why do you want to give up your time to go across to another country to babysit for 12 hours?
Well, it's a unique opportunity for James and Carolyn to attend the conference together. They couldn't do it without childcare, so we have volunteered to go and give them a hand.
Oh, so it's just a really lovely way of serving our missionaries and going in a very practical way so that they can go and do that. So that's such a wonderful thing to do. And how can we be praying for you, particularly as you look to head off? So when do you head off?
Head off on Friday.
Friday, and so that's for a week?
Yeah, for a week.
So how can we be praying for you?
Well, it'd be great for prayers for straightforward travellers because there's a bit of a tricky with the flights. They keep changing the times. Good health and safe travel. The Webbs are travelling down from Zaya down to southern Spain. There's some prayer cards at the back on the mission table, which has got some points on there, which would be great. But thank you so much.
Brilliant. So we'll pray for you at the end of the service with the Salvianos and the Webbs as well. But we'll be assured of our prayers for you as you go off and serve the Webbs in that way. And we'll love to hear about how it went when you get back as well.
Thank you.
Brilliant. Thanks. Excellent. Pray now. Sorry, Chris. I'm my like a smooth operation. Yes.
Ben was going to say a great time was had here yesterday.
Yes, of course I was.
Would you like to do that?
Yes, I'd love to. Oh, that extra hour kills you, doesn't it? Yesterday evening we had the Light Bright Family Fun Night. So firstly, a huge thank you to everybody who was involved there and coming along. It was a wonderful time. We had about 80 to 100 children and their families in here. The church was transformed. A big thank you for Catherine for organising and putting that together. But pray, actually, that's an opportunity to keep that contact going, to help families to think about the life of the world, but also just to keep thinking about faith and to keep thinking about Jesus. We've got a school at the road. Let's keep praying for them. But thank you again to everybody involved for bringing that all together. So it was great.
Thanks, Ben. Like Abraham, we're saved and lived by faith in our promise-keeping God. We're going to stand to sing. Please stand.
Power of his promise in their hearts, of a holy city built by God's own hand. place where peace and justice reign.
We will stand.
We will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on him, our soul's reward, till the race is finished and the work is done. We'll walk by faith and not by sight. Saw the day when the Lord for Messiah would appear with the power to break the chains of sin and death and arise triumphant from the grave. By faith the church was called to go in the power
second reading carries on in Genesis 24 from verse 28 on page 24 in the church Bibles. Denise, Timo, Evie Mae, Lizzie and Oliver are going to come and read that for us now, and afterwards Nick will speak.
The young woman ran and told her mother's household about these things. Now Rebekah had a brother named Laban, and he hurried out to the man at the spring. As soon as he had seen the nose ring and the bracelets on his sister's arms, and had heard Rebekah tell what the man said to her, he went out to the man and found him standing by the camels near the spring.
"Come, you who are blessed by the Lord," he said. "Why are you standing out here? I have prepared the house and a place for the camels."
So the man went to the house, and the camels were unloaded. Straw and fodder were brought for the camels, and water for him and his men to wash their feet. Then food was set before him. But he said,
"I will not eat until I have told you what I have to say."
"Then tell us,"
Laban said. So he said,
"I am Abraham's servant. The Lord has blessed my master abundantly, and he has become wealthy. He has given him sheep, and cattle, silver and gold, male and female servants, camels and donkeys. My master's wife Sarah has borne him a son in her old age, and he has given him everything he owns. And my master made me swear an oath and said, you must not get a wife for my son from the daughters of the Canaanites, in whose land I live, but go to my father's family and to my own clan and get a wife for my son. And then I asked my master, what if the woman will not come back to me? He replied, the Lord, before whom I have walked faithfully, will send his angel with you and make your journey a success, so that you can get a wife for my son and from my own clan and from my father's family. You will be released from my oath if, when you go to my clan, they refuse to give her to you. Then you will be released from my oath. When I came to the spring today, I said, Lord, God of my master Abraham, if you will please grant success to the journey on which I have come. See, I am standing beside this spring. If a young woman comes out to draw water and I say to her, please let me drink a little water from your jar, and she says to me, drink, I'll draw water for your camels too. Let her be the one the Lord has chosen for my master's son. Before I finished praying in my heart, Rebecca came out with a jar on her shoulder. She went down to the spring and drew water, and I said to her, please give me a drink. She quickly lowered her jar from her shoulder and said, drink, and I'll water your camels too. So I drank, and she watered the camels too. I asked, whose daughter are you? She said, the daughter of Bethuel, son of Nahor, whom Michal bore to him. Then I put the ring on her nose and the bracelet in her arms, and I bowed down and worshipped the Lord. I praised the Lord, the God of my master Abraham, who had led me on the right road to get the granddaughter of my master's brother for his son. Now if you will show kindness and faithfulness to my master, tell me, and if not, tell me, so I may know which way to turn.
Laban and Bethuel answered,
this is from the Lord. We can say nothing to you one way or the other. Here is Rebecca. Take her and go, and let her become the wife of your master's son, as the Lord has directed.
When Abraham's servant heard what they said, he bowed down to the ground before the Lord. Then the servant brought out gold and silver jewelry and articles of clothing and gave them to Rebecca. He also gave costly gifts to her brother and to her mother. Then he and the men who were with him ate and drank and spent the night there. When they got up the next morning, he said,
send me on my way to my master.
But her brother and her mother replied,
let the young woman remain with us 10 days or so, then you may go.
But he said to them,
do not detain me. Now that the Lord has granted success to my journey, send me on my way so I may go to my master.
Then they said,
let's call the young woman and ask her about it.
So they called Rebecca and asked her,
will you go with this man?
She said, so they sent their sister Rebecca on her way, along with her nurse and Abraham's servant and his men. And they blessed Rebecca and said to her,
our sister, may you increase to thousands upon thousands. May your offspring possess the cities of the enemies.
Then Rebecca and her attendants got ready and mounted the camels and went back with the man. So the servant took Rebecca and left. Now Isaac had come from Beer Lahai Roy, for he was living in the Negev. He went out to the field one evening to meditate, and as he looked up, he saw camels approaching. Rebecca also looked up and saw Isaac. She got down from her camel and asked the servant,
who is that man in the field coming to meet us?
He is my master,
the servant answered. So she took her veil and covered herself. Then the servant told Isaac all he had done. Isaac brought her into the tent of his mother Sarah, and he married Rebecca. So she became his wife, and he loved her, and Isaac was comforted after his mother's death.
Well done, team. Fantastic. So, we've got a fairy story that's not a fairy story, a love story that's not really a love story, but a story about how the whole world is going to be healed. Do you notice how it ends? Isaac is comforted after his mother's death. His mum dies in the previous chapter. The shadow of death has been hanging over the human race ever since the third chapter of the book of Genesis. And there's something happening here that just takes away the sting of death. I don't think that's a coincidence. This isn't just a story about boy, well, servant meets girl meets boy, and they live happily ever after. It's like all fairy stories. It's pointing us to something much, much bigger. If you read Genesis 24 and think, this is going to be how God blesses me, he is going to provide the handsome prince, the beautiful princess, and that is going to bring me joy and I will live happily ever after. Well, look, those of us who've lived long enough know that's not true, don't we? That's not how the story ends. Some of us will never marry. Some of us have married and regret it. Others of us have married and it's been a great joy, and then death has come as the bitterest blow as it separated us. Marriage cannot solve your problems. And yet, here is a marriage that somehow seems to be at the heart of how God is going to make every sad thing come untrue. Why is that? Well, when you get to the New Testament of the Bible, you find something quite interesting. In the first three Gospels, Jesus keeps calling himself the bridegroom. And then in John, the fourth Gospel, John sets out seven signs that point to who Jesus is, the Son of God, the Messiah, who's come to bring everlasting life, eternal life to God's people, to take away the sting of death. What is the first sign that Jesus performs in John's Gospel? Does anyone know? Anyone want to tell me? Denise. He turns water into wine. And Denise, where does he turn water into wine?
Because they need it.
They need it. And where?
At Cana.
At Cana. And what's happening in Cana? A wedding. Jesus' first sign is at a wedding. He brings the joy to the wedding. He brings the wine. And then almost the next thing that happens in John's Gospel is that the disciples of John the Baptist are really worried because people are going to Jesus to be baptized instead. And they say to John, look, they're all running after him and they're all going and being baptized by him. What do you want us to do about it? And you know what John says? To this, John replied, a person can receive only what is given them from heaven. You yourselves can testify that I said, I am not the Messiah, but am sent ahead of him. The bride belongs to the bridegroom. The friend who attends the bridegroom waits and listens for him and is full of joy when he hears the bridegroom's voice. That joy is mine, and it is now complete. He must become greater, I must become less. John the Baptist says, look, I'm just the best man at this wedding. Jesus is the bridegroom. And then I wonder if anyone knows what happens next in John's Gospel. Jesus goes to a well. And what happens when he goes to the well? He's got nothing to draw water with, and he meets a woman and says, will you give me a drink? Does that ring any bells? It really should. And she says, you are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? She knows the story too. You're not to get a bride for my son from these people. You see, the Samaritans are a kind of mix of Jewish and Canaanite. She knows that Jesus can't marry her. Why are you coming here and going through the whole kind of water from the well rigmarole ritual thing? I can't be your bride. And Jesus said, if you knew who I am, you'd have asked me for a drink. I can give you water welling up within you to eternal life so that you will never be thirsty again. In other words, I can really, really give you what you need if you'll only ask. And she's confused, and Jesus says, go and get your husband. She says, I don't have a husband. And he says, I know. The man you live with now is not your husband, and the five husbands you've had before haven't satisfied you. You see, marriage wasn't the answer for her. Men weren't the answer for her. But Jesus, the bridegroom, is the answer. You see, the whole Bible is one way of looking at it, is that it's a fairy story. It is a love story in which the prince finds his princess and they live happily ever after. Listen to what Isaiah says to God's people. The Lord will take delight in you and your land will be married. As a young man marries a young woman, so will your builder marry you. As a bridegroom rejoices over his bride, so will your God rejoice over you. Jesus, God himself, comes into the world as a bridegroom to marry his bride, the church, to welcome his people into his family. So how does the Bible end? Chapter 19 of the book of Revelation. Alleluia, for our Lord God Almighty reigns. Let us rejoice and be glad and give him glory. For the wedding of the Lamb, that is Jesus, has come, and his bride has made herself ready. Fine linen, bright and clean, was given her to wear. Fine linen stands for the righteous acts of God's holy people. Then the angel said to me, write this. Blessed are those who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb. And then in chapter 21, we read this. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain. For the old order of things has passed away. My dear friends, if you are Christian people, you are part of that beautiful bride that the Prince of Heaven came and gave his life for. And you will live happily ever after. That is the extraordinary truth that Genesis 24 points us to. And it is breathtaking, isn't it? I don't know how you think God thinks about you. I'm often tempted to think that God rather reluctantly accepts me, that I might squeak through the pearly gates of heaven with a bit of a tut ringing in my ears. But tell me this. Have you ever been at a wedding and seen the groom turn round and go, I've been to lots of weddings. I've taken a lot of weddings. I've married a lot of people. And I promise you, that is not the look you get, is it? As a bridegroom rejoices over his bride, so will God rejoice over his people. Bible is a love story between God and his people. From the very beginning to the very end, God is finding a wife for his son, the Prince of Heaven. So no matter whether you're married or not, whether you're filled with grief right now or filled with joy, there is a day coming for which your heart has been longing from the moment you were born, when God will wipe away every tear and fill your heart with joy and welcome you to his banquet, to the wedding supper that you were born for. And making sure that Isaac got his wife is just another link in that chain so that God could bring you to that day.
Good morning, everyone. Let us pray. As we continue to pray and give thanks for our October Mission Month and the guest speakers who have visited us each week, we also pray for those around the world who are persecuted for their belief in you. We thank you, Lord, for the organisations like Barnabas, whom we have supported in the past through JHMT, and the help that they give to believers in need. Father God, we are mindful that your word tells us that those who persevere to the end will be saved. We recognise that we are living in a time of persecution when Christians are falling away from the faith and betraying one another. False prophets are leading people astray and wickedness is increasing, a time prophesied by your Son. Yet he also promised that nobody will snatch us out of his hand or yours. Preserve us, we pray, as you promise in your word, for we ask it in his name. Amen. This week we are praying for our mission partners Fran and Martin Russell, who serve in the national leadership team for Agape Italia, and they're living in Florence, Italy. They ask that we give thanks for the recent time when all the staff of Agape Italia met at Assisi. This is one of their annual events. All the staff can get together, pray and encourage one another. Please pray for Martin and the national leadership team as they finalise plans and financial budgets for the next few years, that they are led by the Holy Spirit. Please also pray for the two new staff members to join Martin's operations team, Tiffany and Alessandro, as they sort out their accommodation and financial needs. Fran is volunteering as membership secretary for the American International League of Florence. Praise God for the opportunities she has had to share her faith through this group of women, and pray she can continue to be a bright witness to them. Please pray for Fran and Martin's health, that the Lord will continue to give them the strength and stamina they need to continue serving with him with Agape in Italy. Amen. We pray for our country, which currently has a new king and a new prime minister. Please give them the wisdom to make the right decisions with the future of the country at stake. There are many people relating to the cost of living crisis which are causing great concern for people who in some cases are having to or will have to make a decision between turning the heating on or food on the table this winter. Please guide those who have the power to help to make the right decisions at the right time for those most in need. Amen. We pray, Lord, for the people of South Korea and the appalling tragedy that we're hearing about in the news. Please be with them at this terrible time. Amen. We pray for our church and members of BH. There are many who are suffering at this moment in time through ill health and financial issues. We particularly pray for Jim, that he may receive the right care and attention as to his needs. We give thanks for the Light Bright Family Fun Night yesterday, and for the commitment of the organisers and helpers and those who attended, making such a joyful event with you, Lord, at the centre. We also give thanks for the other events which happen every week, which will be returning after the half-term break. We particularly think of Cameo, Tuesday Group, Tiddlywinks, Coffee Stop and all the regular youth groups. We give thanks to their leaders for the commitment that is shown to those who attend the events that are laid on. We also give thanks for Nick, Ben and the staff members for all that they do for our churches, BH, Holy Cross and Goldstone. Amen. We We're now going to end this time of prayer with the collect for the day, the fourth Sunday before Advent. Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son, Christ our Lord. Grant us grace so to follow your blessed saints in all virtuous and godly living, that we may come to these inexpressible joys that you have prepared for those who truly love you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Thanks, Clive. Today's All Saints Sunday. That's why the collect was thus. Because Tuesday is All Saints Day, a time when Christians remember with thanks all those believers who have gone ahead of us into glory. There's a great song written many years ago, especially, and it was published in 1864 first, so maybe even James Hannington sang it. We're going to sing some of it together, four verses. It's got 11, so you'll be pleased about that. Some of the language, because it was written then, is Old English, and it helps to know that when we sing about the Holy Ghost, it's the old name for the Holy Spirit. As it may not be familiar to everybody, we're going to listen to the tune and then we'll stand to sing.
Fortress and their pride, thou, Lord.
Well, a big thank you to everyone who's taken part in the service this morning. There will be refreshments after this in the centre, and Liz's library is available as well. And we're coming back in here, some of us, to pray for our mission partners in just a little while. But first, we're going to close the service by praying for each other in the words of our verse for the year, which will be on screen from Romans 15. Together. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope. Amen. The Holy Spirit. Amen.